Do I think the United States is fatalistic in order to think it views itself as fatalistic in order to protect Israel?
Right.
Tell me what that means. Yes. What do you think about how would that make us fatalistic?
Well, like it's our fate to be in good terms with Israel.
Like we're predetermined to be protector of Israel. Do I think the United States thinks that, or do I think that?
Do you think the United States thinks
that? Yes, I think that the Bible Belt thinks that. Dispensationalist theological Christians. That does not include Seventh-day Adventists, at least officially. But there's a number of the laity within the Adventist Church that actually agree with most of the like big Protestant America, you know, Bible Belt, evangelical, conservative Christians. It's based on the notion that God's covenant with Israel was permanent, and that still they have a role to play for people. Seventh-day Adventists, on the other hand, teach that at the moment that the veil in the temple was torn, it was too tall for anyone to reach it, was torn with unseen hands from top to bottom at the moment that Jesus yielded his spirit on the Friday of the crucifixion, that at that point, the covenant that had been made, they had finally broken it to the point that now the new covenant was with spiritual Israel, so that the covenant he made with the nation of Israel now was with those that were in spiritual Israel, which were the followers of Jesus. So Seventh-day Adventists teach that there's no special regard for Israel any more than there is for any other people here. I can argue both sides. If I believed that it was my God-appointed duty to take care of them, that they were still special anointed, some people believe that the reason that God keeps blessing the United States to the degree that he does, which is imagined to be the case, that's believed. Over and above other nations, is because they're taking care of Israel. And as long as they do that, they'll enjoy God's special protection, they'll win the wars they engage in, they'll have economic domination over the rest of the world. That is common, in fact, maybe most Christians in the United States believe that. I'm not going to say it's un-Christian, but I will say it's diametrically opposed to the philosophy and teachings and example of Jesus. But one thing we need to keep really clear, Jesus was definitely not a Christian. Jesus was not a Christian. And for the most part, Christianity does not follow Jesus' teachings. They're against many of Jesus' main teachings. Christianity is not surprising. Throughout history, the founders of spiritual and religious movements, their followers end up attributing to them typically the things that they were most against. Because usually they're people who are against the status quo and against the institutions of the day because those institutions have become manipulated to the point that powerful people are abusing the weak. And most of the time when somebody has the spiritual fervor of a mystic, especially in Jesus' case. It's to suggest that that's not appropriate, that it's never appropriate, and they usually resist sort of organizing that kind of an institution while they're alive, and as soon as they're gone, and that's what their followers get rid of. When oppressed people are given power, as often as not, they become twice the oppressor as those that oppress them. There's an imagination when people are poor today. They don't want anything to change in terms of having a caste system because they actually believe the American dream is that they're going to end up there. And when it happens, they want their turn to have more than other people. It's a little bit like when I was a high school freshman, it was perfectly legal and it was okay with the school officials to haze freshmen, to do initiation pranks and rituals and all that stuff. In fact, faculty would take part. When I went to Sacramento Academy, 1976, I started my freshman year. Literally, faculty were helping and providing resources to the upperclassmen to haze the freshmen. And during my freshman year, toward the end of my freshman year, there had been a lot of pranks that went bad in the country. West Point was a real famous one. They had some ridiculous thing where they had like a blade, a big blade that on a weighted thing that was pretty scary, and it was set up so that the person was supposed to have it start here and then go out and then come back, and there was a board that was supposed to go, and they had some device. Well, the device failed and it killed somebody. And that was just one of a slew of these things that went bad. So it became a federal law in the education code that you cannot haze to initiate people in an educational setting. So the people in my class were sort of like, wait a minute, you know, we had our underpants pulled up, you know, all the way up. And we had frog guts in our locker and got thrown in the ocean on the school trip and all this stuff. You know, where's our outlet? So that's kind of like people are hoping, yeah, I'll let it change after I get, you know, get a chance to serve some out. That's not an altruistic or very Jesus-like motive to want to maintain a caste system. Let's pray and we'll talk some more. Father in heaven, we're grateful that we have the example that we do. We're grateful that we're promised that it is possible for our characters to improve. And we're grateful for the hope that we have of salvation in Jesus' name. Amen. There are many things going on in the government. Suffice it to say that in these cycles, it's the first time in any of your memories that we've had quite this kind of a like when the roulette wheel comes around, it like comes up on this number. But it happens cyclically. Not just our country, but all over the world. It is a logical outcome of a semi-democratic republic. No matter what form of government, clever people manage to find ways to get more than their share. My dad's parents and their same, but explained their notion of the political economic structure of the world. They said that in order to understand how life works, you just need to realize that the big ones take it away from the little ones, and then the smart ones take it away from the big ones. And that's kind of what you're seeing. Any history majors here? Anyone have a real interest in U.S. history? Okay. If you want to have something to compare it to, the way it might play out, might not too, but it might play out, take a look at Andrew Jackson's presidency. You'll find some parallels, and the way that the presidency is now handling things sort of by fiat right now, Jackson did a lot of that, and he was willing to flip the bird to the courts and to the legislators, and he got a lot of things done. So his list had a lot of things checked off of it, and some of them persistent. He's on the $20 bill right now. A few of the things that he did ended up being good things by most people's standards. A lot of things that he did upset a lot of people and set a tone for the country that maybe we're not completely recovered from. You know, it's a young country that we're in. It's a very young country, and we see things that are confusing, and that's not an accident. People split the agendas between two, like, ball teams. They take what would, like, logically go together with a person reasoning consistently, and they put half of it over here and half of it over here, and they take the other half and do that like this, so that it doesn't ever make complete sense, and it allows the parties to turn on a dime and still be true to half of each in any presidency or in any midterm election. It allows being able to shift and say, well, look, we're doing this. I know that compromises this other stuff. I know, I'm sorry, but this right now, this is our party's agenda, and we have to take care of it. And then later on, when it's convenient, they can just dial it the other direction. We're going to talk about politics, because politics is a branch of philosophy. And when we talk about what Plato talked about, and he has Socrates in the dialogues, in the plays that he wrote, saying about politics. Athens, where Socrates and Plato lived, was a democracy, and that was not a common thing. It was not exactly like we think of a democracy. But the U.S. isn't a democracy like we think of it as a democracy either. People are profoundly able to entertain ideas that don't make sense together about the way our government is arranged. You got to see that in this election, it didn't matter. It didn't matter what the popular vote was. It didn't matter. People said, well, that's because of the Electoral College. The Electoral College is a device that allows gerrymandering. Gerrymandering means redrawing districts and redrawing all kinds of representation and assigning, like, representative votes or electoral votes in a strategic way that you could never entertain in one thought to make sense of it. Is there anybody here you think you could go to the board and explain to me the logic of it? Like, if you'd been running in this election, how you would have needed to play the Electoral College to get in. Is there anybody who's straightforward to you? It's not to me either. I mean, we could make a spreadsheet, or we could have that make some charts and everything. We could look it up online. But if you looked it up online, you would find information both directions. You would not get a clear statement about it. And if, you remember the card trick that I showed you, if it comes out the way I hope it comes out, if I'm trying to get you to the ace of hearts, and I say, what suit? And you say, clubs, and I say, okay, that leaves the other three suits. And out of those other three suits, you eliminate spades, and then we're left with hearts and diamonds. And I say, so just throw out one. And when I say throw out, I mean that more than one way. I mean that whichever way you necessitate me meaning it. Throw it out means just give me your choice off the top of your head, or it means throw it into the trash if it's the one I don't want. I'll decide that after I hear what your vote is. And then the last card that I allow through that filter of horse manure is the card that's where I know it is in my pocket, and so I can pull it out. We get excited if we make a referendum for the ballot, so that there's a proposition that people forced, the legislators didn't put it there. We got enough signatures, and we got it cleared by the courts, and it goes on the ballot. And then we go to the polls, and we vote it. Now, if people that are wealthy and powerful, legislators that are on the take and getting all kinds of bribes for voting a certain way, people that have campaign promises to fulfill, if the vote comes out the way they want, they say, see how the process works? You guys, congratulations, and good try, too. You almost got it. But if it does pass, then a federal judge, if it's not something that the powerful people and their feds want, a judge will then rule that it's not actually constitutional, and it will be stricken. It won't be stricken immediately. It'll be given a stay, and then it'll hang out in the courts for a couple of years until all the coalitions break up and there's no nexus, there's no constituency that's organized. They've gone different ways, they're on to something else. And then, when it looks like they're really concerned about other things, they'll create an event in the news that's huge, and then that afternoon, they'll just say, oh, and by the member, that's got to go. And then you won't have your law. That's how it's played. If, however, it was just played really straightforward, we could be seeing exactly what we're seeing right now in the presidential election. If you go on Facebook and you look at your own friend group, unless you're like really trying to be homogenous, to have only people agree with you on your deal. I've got, 1,300 or 1,400 friends, and they're from all ages and all parts of the world, and I've got people that are saying, in my context, that are saying, finally, let's get rid of all those Muslims. And then we've got other people in my contact list that are saying, what's going on here? I don't recognize my country. There's really a division in kinds of people. And that division isn't a static line. It depends on what issue. That's what it is to divide the parties the way I was describing, where you take half of the stuff that makes sense together and put it in one party and half in the other party. If the Republican Party was truly concerned to have less government and less nanny babysitting telling you, like a child, what you can and you cannot do, then it would be consistent with that. But it's not. The same party that says you should be able to have a gun is telling you you can't make up your own mind about religious things like abortion. And on the other side, you've got equally confusing nonsense from the Democrats the way it's divided up. I have no loyalty to either party, and half of those issues I really could argue both ways. But that's not what's important. What's important is that it's a flow of ideas and a flow of money, and people have figured out how to put a turbine, a generator, on all those kinds of flows and become unimaginably wealthy. You know what Jesus' attitude was about that whole federal process? Do you remember what Jesus said about the whole federal government in his day? He just steered clear of it. People asked him about paying taxes, and he hadn't paid his taxes because he wasn't working at the time. He was walking around and eating what people gave him, and they really didn't tax it. They just wanted a certain amount of money in the life. And he said, go catch a fish. When they caught a fish, there was a coin in the fish's mouth. Give it to him. I mean, that demonstrates how He's not impressed with their power. He's the ruler of nature. He demonstrated in his response. But he said, you know, another time, should we pay taxes? He said, well, whose name was on the money? Caesar. Well, guess it's his. Give it to him. He just didn't care about money or taxes or the federal government. Nothing. Yes.
I
just
had a friend who was making that point, like, God puts people into authority and respect them and whatnot. But,
well, that's what Romans 13 says.
Right, and that's the chapter he referenced.
But that's the same thing they said in Nazi Germany.
Exactly
what they said in Nazi Germany. There are no simple answers. Simple minds require simple answers. This course is about how to recognize that you can't afford to be simple-minded. And it's to put you on notice that nearly, absolutely everybody is. And that every one of us, if we just relax for a minute, if we stop looking in, we'll miss the fact that we're that way too. Just like with our intelligence illustration where we say somebody's profoundly developmentally disabled, they have an 80 IQ and we have 120 IQ, they look to us and their reasoning resembles to us what 160 IQ would think looking at us. Same thing with intellectual honesty and complexity of thought. I don't think I've had a month go by where I don't realize what an idiot I was last month. It makes me really reluctant to get up there and rant for the whole world on social media. I'd be so embarrassed if I was saying some of the things on social media that I rant around the house. You know? And things that I'm thinking inside and going, don't say it. There's just infinite complexity, and every month I get another side to a certain story that I thought was straightforward. You know, I have been in favor of my entire life of governments not taking firearms or other weapons away from people because it makes you so the government, you don't have any way to deal with the government if you need to. And our founders said it's our moral duty to overthrow the government if it comes to that point and we need to have the arms in order to do it. Plus, I think its logic is ridiculous. To allow the only people who are walking around with a gun to be people who don't care about the law. That scares me. Then I go to the range, a public range, and I watch how people shoot, and I say, oh, geez. And I watch how they handle their stupid car when all the road rage. You know, that scares me. I know how people reason. I know how they get upset. I spent almost 16 years as a cop, and I'm really scared of making the wrong choice. And many times, I have chosen to be unarmed in situations where it might have been a better idea to be armed, because I thought, and this is so backwards, well, this is the kind of thing where something could go down. Now think of the irony. Because I'm scared to death of making the wrong decision or of just being part of a degree off when I'm nervous, when I pull the trigger, it scares me to death. I'd rather take a bullet than shoot somebody that shouldn't be shot any day. So it's not simple. It's not simple. It's not simple either about whether or not one benefit or another ought to be just a given, a right rather than a privilege. It's hard to say. I spent a year when I was at Andrews University. I spent a year as the student wellness program director and the assistant director of personnel wellness, and the director of or coordinator of a comprehensive employee health care cost reduction study for the university, which was self-insured. insured for its health benefits. This is before benefits started getting like they are now. It was just simple. You had a job, you go to the doctor, they pay for it, period, done deal. That's it. It wasn't, I mean, this was the beginning of the era of, boy, we should turn that back. Why are we listening to physicians when we could be listening to MBAs to tell us what to be done? So I went through every claim that had been submitted for the past decade for Andrews University. I went through and I evaluated each claim, one at a time. It took a whole year, and it took hours and hours and hours way into the night. And there were people who would have a bit of a rash, a little, a few pimples out of place that would drive to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, because only the best is good enough for their pimple. And do you know what that cost the university? Instead, the university had a doctor's office with two jet hot family practice physicians, identical twins. They were, I would be willing to go find them today. They were exceptionally skilled and exceptionally compassionate men. Excellent. It was on campus. And those guys could have looked at that and said, you know what? Quit scratching that. And that would have been the end of it. And it would have cost, you know, the school $15. But no, $1,500 later, they go to Minnesota and they say, quit scratching it. End of story, go home. Here's the bill, Andrews. So if you just give it, and it's just so easy, then you think people are bad having access to WebMD today. You would have a percentage of the population who would spend more time at the doctor than they did at work, when really what they need is to get off their butt and get busy and quit scratching. They get told by one person, and that should be enough, you know. But at the other end, you have miserable stories of people who get aced out, fall between the cracks, and they die because you allow business people to be jerking around with actuarial figures while someone needs immediate attention. Well, we're not sure. We'll take it to a committee. Trained to tell you no until you basically sue them into saying yes, and they die before the thing can run its course. I don't have an answer. I don't know what would be the best thing. I fall on the side of probably the best thing. If you just required me to give you an answer right now, and then it was going to get implemented, I would make healthcare a basic right. Period. And I would have physician referees, not businessmen referees. And I would have things in place to identify hypochondriacs, and they would receive special attention of another kind. It turns out that a lot of times, if you would let them go get a massage once a week, they would stay out of the clinic. That helps. If you bring in a masseuse in-house, people get touched, and somebody says, oh yeah, I feel this, and they make up a term for it or whatever. And they say, oh yeah, someone considered me, because they need that attention. They didn't get it at some point when they were children, or something. And I would probably give everybody a basic income. It wouldn't be huge, but it would keep you out of the gutter and out of the street. And then if you wanted to work and become wealthy, then more power to you. But I would limit personal wealth to some reasonable degree, so that the taxation above that for everything you possess and everything you earn would be taxed at 100%. Go ahead, play the game, but you're going to turn it in at the end. Because individuals should not get most of the money in circulation. If they do, they can't be held accountable. There's no way to hold them accountable. You can't afford to ever prosecute them. There's no way that they have to follow the rules that everyone else has to. The there's no way their kids get treated the same by the cops as somebody in, you know, low income brackets. And that's not okay.
How does that work then if, from an ethical, like my friend just wants to become a garbage man. Like he wants to, like he like finds joy in like emptying the trash off the street and throwing it back to the truck. And I'm like, oh, I think I'm gonna be like a specialty in like some kind of special orthodontic thing. Mm-hmm. So it's like 4-year college plus their like whatever 8 years.
You're gonna make a bungload more money than you.
So then, if you're saying that like everyone be taxed over a certain point at 100%.
Oh, it would be a huge amount of money. I don't mean like $100,000. I mean, enough to make you happy, really, really.
Okay, like
a lot of money, and that would change. It depends on how much is in circulation, and you'd look at the tables and you'd say, we can't have 3 or 4 people having all, you know, more than half of the money in the country. But I would say, it would be huge, like $100 million. It would be big, because there's no reason to not have people that are makers and that are making good things for other people that put out. They should be rewarded. But there comes a point where you get so much money, you're not getting it so you can enjoy life. You're getting it because you enjoy making sure other people don't. And we don't need to allow that. And anybody who we find functioning in a way that's taking shot and fruit economically, go to prison. You don't enjoy getting people out their house. You know, we would build that in so that just wasn't going to happen.
You mentioned paying minimum income. Don't you think that would still be people that would find ways of like throwing that away?
Yes. Yes.
Uh-huh. And they would still find themselves in like a bad place.
Like they want to be a hobo on the railroad track with a stick in it and their possessions hanging from the end of it. Exactly. What happens in Alaska or Kuwait? It's exactly what happens in both places where they want money. Exactly what happens. It's a good system. Society doesn't fall apart. There's still plenty of motivation and industry. You can still get workers, lots of workers. So all those arguments say you can't, it's nonsense.
What are the two places again?
Alaska and Kuwait. You get an allowance. You get a reverse tax. If they're not feeding their kids, though.
And they're not feeding their dogs, not taking care of themselves and their family.
Right. Well, you know, there comes a point, I mean, and we can discuss who, but there's certain folk that that are seeing, like, people that aren't there and everything, and they're hearing voices telling them to hurt other people. And before the Proposition 13 Jarvis Gannon Initiative, back when I was actually a bit younger than you, in California and the rest of the country. It started in California and it was a big movement across the country. If you were needing a mental hospital, you were in a mental hospital. You weren't laying in urine-soaked clothes out on a heating grate down on Main Street. If you were mentally ill, you were put someplace and treated with decency. Clean bed, TV, a huge grassy tree. Napa State Hospital was that before it was a prison. Prison now. Psychiatric prison. But before it was a psychiatric prison, when it was actually just a mental hospital, that's where I did my abnormal psychology exams when I was a student at UC. And people that you see on the street, never saw those people on the street. Went to the state hospital to see those people. They ate decent. I sat there and ate the same food they did. I sat there in the day room watching TV with them. Took a bowling. Walks out. And it's a very beautiful place. Now they're in jail or they're in the street.
Why are they in jail?
Because they break the law. As soon as they break the law, then they go to jail. If they're on the street, it's because they didn't break the law. criminally insane and you do something that's a major felony, like you kill somebody, but you're not going to go to Napa State Hospital for shock devices. You just go to jail. For, you know, stupid vandalism, writing cuss words on the side of the building, home before or something. You're just going to go to jail. And then you do stuff while you're in jail that gets you socked up and you fight and get in trouble. You stay there longer. But people that are like that, I've had people going and asking me to put them in jail. They would come say, could you just put me in jail? It's like 17 degrees outside. And they're freezing. And they're seeing me heading in to go work in the justice system and saying, what would it take for me to be able to go to jail? I said, I can't put you in jail. No, seriously. I mean, say I did something. I said, see, it's plus out a toothache. I want to see the dentist tomorrow. So you've been inside before. I have. You have anything pending? Got any warrants?
No.
Run me and see. Okay. No, they don't. So, okay. Sorry, dude. Why don't you go see that shelter? No, they're full. Okay. So I turn around, start heading in, and you hear glass break. You went and got a rock from the planter, and did two headlights and patrol cars in the parking lot. But now I can do it. I've had it happen 3 or 4 times, just almost like that. People, they got released, and they say, please don't release me. I want to stay. I know if I get out, I'm going to be high again, and then I'm probably going to die this time. So they go out in the lobby, pick up a chair, put it through the window, and then wait.
So, do you think that not just there is an insanity, that law that sometimes people are insane, but because it's such a hard one to qualify for, that it keeps...
Yeah, it almost never happens. We'll give people that are insane the death penalty. Absolutely. I've seen it. You better believe it. There's people that are nuts. And they don't understand right from wrong. And they go to prison. And then they get taken advantage of her in prison and get protected in prison.
So you're saying when you were a student here, society was, I don't know if I understood correctly, but society was okay with
it. Was just
pain,
transitioning.
Paying for people that were less fortunate.
Correct.
For many reasons.
Correct. Our state taxes, state by state, were very much higher, mostly property taxes. The Jarvis Gann Initiative, Prop 13, was important because, I'm arguing the other side now, what was happening was real estate values were climbing, like with another digit that could be added in a year. So somebody retires and their house is paid for. They paid $11,000 for it. So it gets reassessed as often as their county assessor is prompted by the state to go reassess it for its value. So when they reassess it, then you have to ante up a certain percentage of its value for property taxes. But if they paid $11,000 and say that their pension is $18,000 a year, and then the house goes up to $1.2 million in value, their property taxes could be 3 years of their fixed income. They're going to lose their house. So they take the house and sell it at auction, and they're homeless. Go get a little camp trailer. Literally, that was happening to people. So they responded to that by saying, well, the taxes are too high. So one of the things that Jarvis Gann did was it said, when you buy the thing, that's the basis forever. Sell it, then the next people gets assessed, and so that was a huge amount of money over time that they started losing. The states are losing. Plus, they just lowered it in general. They cut out much of the public. California was twice as effective at educating their children as the runner-up. There were no countries or states that had public education as effective as California's. Now we're at the bottom of the outhouse trough.
The reason why I ask is because in today's not SDA but conservative Christian outlets, you know, you hear people saying, well, it's not the government's job to do that. It's churches, it's local. It's
right.
Churches aren't
going to do anything. Yeah. I mean, they're going to do something, but it doesn't even pick the scab off the problem. Yeah. They just don't have it. then people aren't that generous. Horse manure, they're keeping the money to themselves in most cases. Yes, they give, but the people that give are the poorest people. The wealthiest people give the lowest percentage of their income in most cases.
Because reading this chapter, you know, we're talking about morality and all that. You know, you think that if the government's not going to do it, we need to do it as individuals, right? I mean, can't force anybody else.
How are we going to do it? Where are you going to go find a refuge? How are you going to vet them? You know, you need the government. There's certain things that what if somebody's bonkers, insane? You going to bring them in the home with kids in the home?
Right, not your home, but shouldn't we try to do something at our local churches? I mean,
if we try it at a local church, what do the neighbors say?
They get upset.
Right, because you're bringing in that element to their neighborhood. Right. You try to feed people, and they make rules. The same people that are saying, let's just handle it privately. The same people, when you see people go, all right, we'll handle it privately, they demand laws to forbid even feeding the people that can't eat. To make it against the law to hand them a sandwich. Yay, Lord. I mean, there are people that ask that spikes be put everywhere they see these people laying down. It's just hate. It's just hate. Because people are not ethically right. People are profoundly selfish for the most part. There's a... Let's break out the real stuff here. You know, it depends what's right. If you ask somebody what's right, for something to be right means it furthers what they think is good and it discourages what they think is not good or bad, right? Who says what's good and bad? Who's that up to? Society? Who's that? So, the 51% meanest people, is that who decides? The 51% most selfish? The 51% stupidest? Let's think about two things. Do you want to live a good life? Do you want your life to be good?
Yes.
Or do you want it to be crap? I personally want mine to be good. I want yours to be good. Okay? The good life. So we can agree that we all want a good life. How similar do you think our notions of what that means really are? I mean, some people like to base jump. They like to base jump, and they like to do MMA. The good life to them is to take a regular beating on the mat. It's a good time. Some people, the good life is getting cropped so that they can't remember their weakness. I think you can imagine that for all those things I've said, there's people who would not accept that that's what they consider a very good life. Did Mother Teresa live a good life? Was that a life well lived? Nobel Peace Prize, come on. Yeah, but I mean, most people alive today on Earth, would they say, a good, can you admire her?
Personally, yes.
Yeah,
So, there are some people and some lives that you can admire. Martyrs. I admire martyrs. Okay? There's no martyrs, though, that I envy. I don't envy them. But let's be honest. There's people that you envy. Think about it. They're living the good life. Their pool has an indoor part and an outdoor part. Their car has 12 cylinders. Their car, when you start, it goes vroom, vroom. You know what I mean? Instead of people put those little booty horns on their exhaust pipe. I feel bad for them when they do that. That's not, nobody's fool. That doesn't even, that reduces your power. It's kind of sad, you know? People that, they don't have a brand new Unimog. They don't have a Mercedes that's got like four axles, you know, with a big snorkel that comes up top and ladders and all the pipes around it and everything. And inside it's all like fancy neon lighting, you know? Those fancy kids. No, people get a truck because they want to look like they go four-wheeling. So they raise it up so it's this high. That's not good for four-wheeling. They've never left the city. If they have, they roll their stupid truck. It doesn't help. You want big tires, you don't want tall axles and tall center gravities. That's great big truck. Whatever you want to think. Mine. I mean, let's be honest. You see, like, lifestyles of the rich and famous people that have their own Cessna Citation and a Pilot, you know, or Falcon 10, and they're taking around in a Falcon 10. They got a helicopter that takes them to work. They're going, man, that sucks to be in traffic, and they're flying over it, talking to people on their headset, you know. Can you envy anything in this life? You know, people that are always scuba diving in the Caribbean. And I'm going to tell you, if you haven't done that, well, you should. You need to. So, when you say, I want to live a good life, do you mean you want to live an admirable life or an enviable life? What about your kids? When you have kids, you want your kids to be martyrs? You know, raise up a godly woman, raise up a godly man, and then they go get burned at the stake? You want to do that? Or would you rather raise them up, and then when you're talking to people, and you're getting a little bendy out of this, you know, talking to your friends, saying, yeah, they just bought another house in so they're back and forth all the time from Greece to Naples to Harvard. And yeah, her practice has really kind of taken off, and she's kind of thinking of bringing some other people in, maybe having her own hospital. And you're going, oh, yeah. But you probably don't want to say, yeah, they went up on the Amazon to do some mission work, and they died of dysentery. A whole lot of them. Both my son and my daughter and their families and their children all died of anemia dysentery. You got to really admire their sacrifice. But is there honestly how you want your life to go? How are we going to ask for a clear voice from the country on this when each one of us ourselves? Yes, Samantha.
I don't know how you would tell the country this, but on a personal level, I think it's about contentment. And because you can
Yes, you can. Have you always been content? Have you always been content? Have you had some discontent? So at any time, you know, that part of your life, are you content now? What percentage of your life have you been content? It fluctuates on the day. So in the country, that's a reality times 350 million. It's probably actually less than half that are content at any one point. Either way. Okay, that's important because research proves that the greatest bang for your buck, even if we're talking about money, but it's true of time, it's true of anything, of allocating your resources over which you have prerogative. The greatest way to make yourself happier is to give it to someone else or to give it to a charity. Period. Yes. Have trouble.
Not that you should not that you shouldn't take care of yourself, but I mean, personally, the times I don't have the time open, I'm not long enough to what I'm talking about.
Yes. It's very difficult for me to picture you wearing a Make America Great Again hat at a Trump rally. Just by the tone of your temper. Actually picturing you or anybody like you being there and embracing that kind of agenda. But there's people here that I would say, yeah, maybe.
I think
you
really stereotype.
Well, you know why we stereotype? Because of the 80-20 rule. The thing that kind of gets us when people stereotype about us, is that people like us about 80% of the time, the thing they're saying is probably true. But the 20% is either the way we are or the way we're wanting to see ourselves. And prejudice is almost not ever without some basis. Doesn't mean it gives you the whole story. The person pointing fingers at you or your group, they and their group could be twice as guilty of it. But that doesn't affect whether it's true of you. In the case of the people that are getting the American boot of fellowship right now, immigrants, as they have come to the U.S. Throughout the United States history, when you get a wave of people who come because things get bad where they come from, when they get here, people attribute to them being stupid. And the same jokes that are more than a century old make the rounds, only you just take out the noun and put in a new noun. When my buddy, who now he works at the library as one of the systems librarians, reference librarian, Pat Benner, when we roomed together in Newton Hall for a year, and he went to Lebanon, and there was conflict in Lebanon, surprisingly, when he was there. But when he got back, he said, you know, all the jokes that people in the United States were telling about Italians and Polish people, he heard the same jokes told about the Syrians when he was in Lebanon. You know, how did the Syrian die drinking milk? The cow cat sat down, you know, and you heard about the Syrian terrorist severely injured trying to blow up a bus. He burned his lips off on the exhaust pipe. So all these things that I had heard since I was born about groups in the United States that were whatever the jokes were about, he heard the same exact jokes on the other side of the earth about whoever it was having a hard time and needed a place. And so I don't know why we do that. I don't know why we do it, but it's not true. Find yourself agreeing with their whole agenda, you're probably stupid. You're inconsistent. And you confuse the government and politics and life as a community with a stupid stadium game, you know, a stupid football game or basketball game.
But even like today, like with Facebook and all the different things, you're so like gung-ho in one direction.
Right. Right. You don't have to. Your team is either the jackasses or the elephants. The red or the blue, right? We even got jersey colors in the whole bed. It's just the same thing as a stupid sport. And people are using the same part of their brain. If you put them in a brain scanner, you will find that they engage with politics the same way they engage with hockey. We've got to look at what's the goal. If you're playing basketball, you want to be sure which net is yours, which hoop is yours. If you put it in the other one, then that wrecks the game, I guess. Yeah, you need to tell people playing American football which way they should face. Because if they get confused and turn and run the other way, that I guess is heinous for some reason. So, first of all, we have to ask, do we need to actually live by goals? Do we need to live by goals or don't we? Can we just sort of take things as they go and not establish goals and just kind of get by? I think my dog has a goal. Wow, this year during 2017, I am going to bark in a higher register.
Can't you kind of do both, though? Because you can kind of, like, set yourself a goal, but then also kind of have the mindset of my goals might change. So just kind of have, I guess, have, like, temporary goals because you don't know.
Well, at any one point, and we're a little confused about this, our consciousness, the focal part, like the workspace of the mind, what you're thinking about right now, so just look at that chalk and you're considering the pink chalk thing, wonder if I'm going to drop it. You're thinking about one thing at a time. Now you can cycle through and go think about this, think about the this person over here, think about the fact that, you know, your ankle hurts. Think about what you got to do when you get out of here. Think about your stomach is growling. And, you know, every 10 seconds, you're thinking about, you know what, everybody is. And I don't even have to say what it is. So we've got all these things competing for the spotlight of our focus. But at any time, we're doing one thing. So first of all, we have to say that yes or no. Are you gonna say I'm goal driven? Some people you go, obviously not. He's 43 and he's still sitting right where he was playing the same video game as, you know, when his parents bought him his Commodore 64 back in, you know, still sitting there eating those Cheetos and have never had a job and college didn't go that well and back home and I'm there. I got no goals. I just kind of take it as it comes. If that smells good, I'll go eat it. Whatever. You don't need a goal. You could, you know, I could paint a better picture. You could say, I don't like the rat race. I disapprove of all the exploitation and all of the false motivations and scrutiny and judgment and unkindness. Selfishness. I'm just going to go and I'm going to join a Tibetan Buddhist monastery. I'm just going to go study. But what's your goal in doing that? I don't have a goal. I just prefer to be there. I'm not sure that Henry David Thoreau had a goal, really, when he was living at Walden Pond. Might have had a series of smaller ambitions, but for the most part, he was just experimenting with coexisting without being part of the crap fest. And what came of it, I think, would have surprised him greatly. And that's not a coincidence that two Buddhist examples, because he was motivated by the Buddhist literature that he was reading, as were the other transcendentalists in that era, Ralph Waldo Emerson, chief among them. But some of the things that he ended up saying in Walden and Civil Disobedience ended up being the inspiration for Gandhi. And Gandhi, in turn, ended up basically providing the playbook for Dr. King. And then Dr. King and Gandhi and Thoreau ended up impacting Mandela. So sometimes it's just sort of people want to just exist. So this is right here an important thing. And it's not a given. It's not disrespectful or unrespectable to say, I'm not really goal-driven. I just kind of don't want to make deep footprints. That's all. I want to be respectful. It's not a goal. It's just practice. So, but if you are goal-driven, so you're pursuing something, you want something to be more of or less of or something, there's a major split in kinds of people. People would like to find out what's actually true, and some people, everything to them, everything, is a contest they have to win. And everything that's a contest that they have to win is a contest that they need to be sure someone else loses, or their life doesn't have purpose. This is the split right here. This is the split where Jesus and the disciples went their separate ways philosophically. But the disciples never changed that part. there's some particular issues that they were hanging us on. Like Paul was trying to kill Christians and all that. He was holding the coats while they actually made a martyr. And so he didn't. He changed that part of himself, and he changed his value system by saying, "Okay, I'm going to say this is good, and I used to say this was bad, and that which I used to say is bad, I'm now going to say is good." But it was still all about winning. It was always a competition. It was always about setting up an organization and gaining territory as a whole. Jesus was basically asking them to seek truth and goodness, honesty, love. This isn't the way of love. Now, Peter, you mentioned, well, can't you maintain more than one thing? Not at a time. What it ends up being is, what percentage of the time do you focus one thing at a time on this, and what percentage this other? But it isn't coherent. It's not about balance. The yin-yang is an Eastern explanation looking for balance, and it isn't the way, it isn't the exact words or the kind of myth that Western philosophy, American civilization, European civilization, they don't identify with the yin-yang idea, if you call it that. But if you simply say it's all about competition and or homeostasis, then they understand that. This is not love. This is about self and about your group. You've always got to find out who you're against. To have victory, you have to have somebody to have victory against. Jesus was trying to say, don't be against anybody. Don't have an out group. Don't look at someone and go, outsider, insider, outsider, insider. Don't do that. They're all inside. Okay? The disciples got rebuked on multiple occasions for wanting to always draw a circle around them. When it comes down to that, depending on the circumstance, you draw a different circle, but then you'll change the circle later on. If it's just to play, or if it's to work, or even at church, look at the warfare as people in the church try to draw a line to decide who's acceptable and who's not acceptable in the church. Look at the warfare that results. Actually, there's a lot of funny ideas about